Hello everyone, welcome to our third webinar. We deal with bridges, with Otto Wagner bridges. And there was an interesting question last time regarding second order theory and how it is implemented in grammar. And that's why I want to take a little digression and talk a little bit about second order theory in general and how it is done in Caramba. As a starting point, I took a very lightweight structure, as you can see it here. It's a tightrope walker. And the tightrope works because of the pretension, the normal force, which is in the rope, and also due to second order effects, which stiffen the whole system. And if we translate now this tight rope into a structural system, it looks then approximately like this. We have two support points. There is a rope, which I will simulate in Caramba as consisting of two truss elements. There's the pre-tension in the cable, which stiffens it. And there is a transverse load, which is, for example, the person walking over the rope. And without the pre-tension, the system wouldn't work at all. Even if these are truss elements, they would be able to rotate because there is no stiffness in this direction. And the stiffness comes from the so-called geometric stiffness, which is induced by these normal forces. And this is also the way how Caramba deals with second order effects. It calculates this geometric stiffness matrix for beams, trusses, and shells. And this either increases the stiffness in case of tension forces, or it decreases the stiffness in case of compression, for example, in case of columns. And that's why columns can buckle, and that's also why it's possible to calculate buckling load factors in finite element programs like Caramba. If you take a look at this system a little bit closer, you see that as soon as the middle node gets deflected a little bit, also the normal forces get deflected. And since there's a slight angle here, there's an upwards component, and this upwards component of these normal forces induces this additional stiffness here. And this second order normal forces are equivalent to a spring, which is placed underneath the point which is free to move. And so the normal force in the system is then equivalent to an additional spring, like here, with this value 4 times the normal force divided by the span. And now let's see how this looks like in Caramba. So the starting point are two lines which get defined here. There's the line which spans the distance between the support points, which is then shattered into two pieces. And these two lines here get fed into the line-to-beam component of Caramba. That's the first thing. Then, if you don't specify anything additional, then this here gives a beam element, which is which has not only actual stiffness, but also bending stiffness. However, in this case, I want to prove that the system works even though the elements do not have any bending stiffness. And that's why I disable the bending stiffness and thereby turn the beams into truss elements. And this disabling of the bending stiffness can either be done directly at the line to beam component via this input plug, or it can be done here via a modify element component. And if I don't specify here any beam IDs on which the component shall act, then it automatically works on all beams which are in the system. And here I disable the bending stiffness. What else do we have here? This modification of the elements also includes the definition of a cross-section. So instead of the default cross-section of a circular hollow cross-section of this diameter, I want to have a relatively thin rope. And that's why I specify here diameter of 3 centimeters. And the thickness I set to half the diameter. So we have a solid circular cross-section here. And for the time being, I leave the material as the default, which is steel. And here, now, if I take a close look at the modify element component, there is a section which is headed by second order. And here I can specify the second order theory behavior of the truss. And this is important here. I have to specify an initial normal force in the truss, because otherwise the system would be kinematic. The system would then be free to translate here. And by setting even a very small normal tensional force, I can prohibit this. And this is only for the first iteration of the calculation. Then the normal forces, which are induced by pre-strain, take over and stabilize the system. What else do we have here? Of course, the supports. We have here 3 translational supports on each side. And this is also something which is specific to truss elements. Truss elements only have 6 degrees of freedom, 3 translations on each side, and they don't have any rotational degrees of freedom. And that's the reason why I don't have to apply here any rotational support, because they're simply not existent. And now come the loads. The person who walks over the tightrope, I estimated a weight of 0.8 kilonewton acting downwards, which corresponds to 80 kilogram gear on Earth. And the position, for the position, I took the points, which are part of the structural system. In my case here, there are for now only 3 points, start, mid, and end point. And I selected here now the midpoint in a parametric way. So if I increase the number of segments, the person still remains in the midst of the rope. So this is the transverse load. And now I define the load which induces the normal force in the rope. And this I'll do using an initial strain on the system. Initial strain is equivalent to a temperature load. Simply tells the solver that there is a pre-existing strain, and the strain is in microstrains, so millimeter per meter, microstrains. And let's see what I wrote here. I assumed that the strength of the steel is 160 kilonewton per square centimeter, which is a high strength post-tensioning steel, for example. By dividing it by the Young's modulus, 21,000 kilonewton per square centimeter, I get the corresponding strain at this strength. By multiplying it by 1,000, I get out microstrains, and I estimated that the cable is tensioned in such a way that 60% of its strength reserve is used up for the pre-stressing of the cable. And this load here then causes the pre-stress which stabilizes the structure. If I would now use a first order theory calculation, let's do it like this. It still works, but it gives me a gigantic displacement. Sometimes one gets results out of first order theory, although one shouldn't, because here in this case, due to the fact that I added here an initial pre-strain, here it is now. I got here initially a response. Now I don't get a response anymore because the system is kinematic, and by adding here this second order theory normal force, again stabilize it. The difference between those two components is that this second order theory component does the structural analysis and then updates the forces which contribute to the geometric stiffness, and this component here does not. So if you specify now a second order theory of normal force here, it will be taken into account even here in first order analysis. However, there will be no update, and the update is done only here. And since the change of the stiffness can lead to different distribution of normal forces, this procedure of calculating the correct geometric stiffness is an iterative procedure, and that's why I have to specify here a maximum number of iterations and the tolerance, so that this re-evaluation of the system stops at some point. And the resulting displacement is 0.7 centimeters. So if we have now a rope of diameter of 3 centimeters and a length of 25 meters, we get under transverse load of 0.8 kilonewton this displacement here. I'll enable now the display of this second order theory normal force again. For the strain specified here, the initial strain component, we get a normal force of roughly 680 kilonewtons. And now there's something interesting from a structural point of view. This normal force, which defines the geometric stiffness, and the actual normal force in the system needn't be the same. So they can be different. However, in my case, they are the same. So if I go here to the beam view and turn on the display of the numbers, I get the same normal force. But the concept here in Caramba is that you can have a normal force which defines the geometric stiffness, and another normal force which induces stresses in the system. Let's see. So this is how it is done in Karamba. And as another deviation, the Golden Gate Bridge works a little bit in the same way. I mean, we have here these massive cables. They are curved so that the dead weight of the structure is translated into normal forces here in the cable. But in addition to this, since this suspension bridge here is a so-called earth-anchored suspension bridge, the forces in the cable also contribute to the stiffness of the bridge itself. So it's not only the stiffness of the bridge deck which is activated, but also the geometric stiffness of these tendons here. And if you look closely, the span of the Golden Gate Bridge is roughly 1.3 kilometers. We have here, this is the rope. It has a diameter of 92 centimeters. And if we adapt now this example here a little bit, if I go here to 1,300 meters and add here a diameter of 92 centimeters, then we have for the strain defined here, although I don't know whether the normal force in the cable is really that large, but we have here then this pre-stressing force, and in case of the truck would have maybe a weight of 250 kilonewtons. We would have here in the middle of the bridge a displacement of 12 centimeters. So one sees that this cable here has quite some transverse stiffness. Okay. So let's go further. Yeah, that's maybe one thing which is important, that the suspension bridge is earth anchored, which means that the cables run here over the pylon and then they're giving the forces into supports to the ground. And also here, that's the same. And if you look closely here, you see that the cable runs further into this support here. The important thing is that the bridge deck is not loaded by compressive loads, because this would then offset the stiffening effect of this tension forces in the cables. Okay, I hope this was clear. I would like to proceed now with the Zollamt bridge. Last time Matthew talked about the arch and what types of loads act on it, and which types of loads can be taken easily or which make problems, like for example the asymmetric loads. And I would like to talk now a little bit about how to come from an arch to a truss, like here. And for this, I made this little drawing here. So if you take a look at this arch, symbolized with this drawing, then the question is how can one make it a little bit smaller or not as high? So one strategy would be to cut this arch into pieces. And if you take a look at the forces which are taken by the supports, we have here compression in the arch, and we have here tension forces. So if you would open up the support in horizontal direction, we would have to add here a tension member so that the system stays an arch system. So that's why if I cut through here, I would have to add here a tension cable and here a compression element to set the forces into equilibrium. And the next step would then be to take those pieces of the arch, so the arch, the tension cable, the compression element, the tension element, and so on, and overlay them in such a way that they are shoved together. So we have here compression, compression, tension, tension, and this can then be stacked together and produces then the truss. And by flipping over this truss, so going from compression arch to catenary, we get a similar system, this time, however, with tension diagonals. So this is symbolized by this little drawing here. So compression is always oriented like this, and tension like this upwards. So in this case here, for example, it's then quite easy to see. We have here the support. So then this must be diagonals under compression, and these here under tension. And I've prepared an example. It's called arch to truss, which does exactly this. The starting point is a parabola. This time, the parabola is formulated with this formula. F is the height of the parabola, L the span. And in order to make this structure self-sustained, I add here a tension element. So it's now possible to release one of the supports here, and okay, we have here the normal forces in the arch. So this compression and here tension. And now here's some grasshopper magic, which calculates the bounding box, cuts the arch, adds the posts, and adds the horizontal elements. And this is then fed into the assembly component. Let's see what happens or what we can change here. So at the moment, the number of segments is 1. And if I change it to 2, you see how the arch is cut into 2 pieces and how the compression is still there. However, here, the tension elements here and here. And this can be done several times. And by repeating this on and on and on, you get something which looks like a truss. One thing to note, maybe, that the diagonals which result are steeper at the supports. That's because if we have here a uniform line load, we have here a triangular distribution of the shear force. So where we have the larger shear force, we also have steeper diagonals. And here is another slider with which I can control into how many segments the arches are subdivided. And here, this is then the truss. One sees very well how the compression and the tension increases, which with each segment. And so if you consider this is one beam, we have of course the maximum bending moment here in the middle under a uniform line load, which would be the classical QL squared divided by 8. Okay. Did I forget something?
Okay. Is
it
live?
It's live, yeah. Fine. Yeah, this is the shape where the diagonals are under compression. And by turning around the structure, by flipping it about the XY plane, I get the corresponding structure, this time with diagonals in tension. Whether one prefers the one shape or the other depends on the material that one has. Or if you look closely, some of the older railway bridges, they have both diagonals. However, the one which is under compression is always much thicker than the one under tension, because of course the elements under compression, there's always the danger of buckling. So that's why one has to have a larger cross section in case of diagonals under compression. Okay, so I'll move on. Well, I didn't climb down to the bridge and take the measures of the profiles. That was not possible. However, Matthew did the definition, and he inputs dimensions of the cross sections, which are approximately like we see it here. And the corresponding definition looks like this. So it's again one side of the bridge, so one half. And the starting point is again here a line of a certain length. So we assumed it to be roughly 30, 35 meters. Then I'll switch off the display of the system here. So this is the baseline, which gets displaced. And the second line then forms the upper girder of the truss, which can also be changed in height, of course. And we estimated the distance between the truss posts to be approximately 3.5 meters. So by dividing the length of the baseline by 3.5, one gets the number of segments for the top and bottom Goethe, and taking this point into the polyline component gives me the upper and lower Goethe, and the posts can be defined using a line component. And for the diagonals, Matthew did a trick. He shifted one list of points by one entry and then used the shortest list components, because by shifting this list of points, one point, the last point drops out. So we have then 1 point lost, and using the shortest list component combines then the longer and the shorter list, but removes automatically the last point of the shorter list, which gives here this one group of diagonals. And doing it the other way around, shifting this list here, one gets the other set of diagonals. Using the entwine component, we can put the structural elements into different branches, which makes it easy to attach identifiers to them. So we have the top and bottom elements, the verticals, diagonals A and B. Here it's important to graft the input so that this list here gets a data tree, which matches then the number of branches here. For the cross sections, it's quite similar. However, this time the grafting was done here. And for the different elements, we took here an AGA 360, which is a European standard steel cross section. And for the diagonals, an IPE. It's, of course, a question whether an IPE is ideal for compression, probably not. However, we choose it. And this component here selects then the corresponding cross sections from the cross section database of Caramba. And this gives them the elements of the truss. The definition of the supports, there are two sets of supports. One is here at the top, which stabilizes the truss, and the others here on the bottom. We have here a fixed point. This point here on the other side can move in the axis direction of the bridge, and we have to. I mean, if everything here, if all elements here would be beam elements, we wouldn't have to add here these supports, because by adding this rotational support, the truss cannot turn over anymore. However, if we look closely here, by defining the line, the beams, we specified also that the IPEs are not beams but trusses, so there is no bending stiffness. Actually, the system would be still stable because the posts are beams, so actually we could do without those supports here. However, let's leave them. Here, these are the top supports, and here this is one support on the, let's see, on the starting point, I suppose. Yeah, starting point, and that's a support somewhere along the bottom girdle. Here also a little trick was applied, which is often quite useful. Matthew, he took the line which forms the bottom girdle, and then by evaluating the curve at some arbitrary parameter t along the curve, it's possible to place now this support freely along the truss. However, since supports can only be attached to to note, it's important that this position here, so 0 is the start of the line, 1 is the end of the line, is translated into a nodal position. And for this, this component here, find similar member, is a great tool. It can be found here under sets. And if you specify here some arbitrary point and specify here a set of points, and for the set of points, let's see it here, our method shows the points, the nodes which make up the lower girder. And this component finds the closest point to this one here, and which is then used for the support here. Yeah, the load is applied to the bottom girder. It's a uniform line load of 10 kilonewton per meter, which is probably not enough because we have some subway trains moving over the bridge. We have rails, we have technical equipment, so it's probably more, but for the example here, it doesn't make a huge difference. And now let's see what we get out here. We have here the mass of the whole structure in kilograms, so the structure here weighs 12.4 tons. And yeah, this would be the structure under this load here, 10 kN per meter. And of course, depending on the position of the support, we get different distributions of normal forces in the upper and lower girder and the diagonals. Here is something still interesting. If you take a look at how the beams are oriented, oops, preview mesh edges, yeah. We see that here this eye profile is rotated. This here would be the default orientation with a horizontal local Y direction. However, if you want to orient it differently, because maybe it's easier to realize here these connections, then we would have to change the default orientation using an orientate element component like you can see here. Of course, it's the question whether this is a good idea. Because if we would have here this eye profile, then water could gather here. However, if we take a look at how it was realized by Otto Wagner, one sees that the web is on the top, so there's no danger of water gathering. This orientate element component can be used to orientate elements. One has to supply the ID of the elements which need to be oriented, and then one can choose which local direction one wants to orientate, and if the local set axis, which by default is parallel to a global set axis, should have a different orientation, one can supply here, for example, a unit Y vector. Or if one wants to add an additional angle, this is also possible, of course, but doesn't make so much sense here. So now it's interesting to see how the orientation has, of course, a huge impact on the structure. One last thing, maybe. Here, this one here. Let's see what happens if we remove the diagonals, because then without the diagonals, we don't have a truss anymore, which is loaded mainly in normal stress. But then we have a so-called Fear and Dale system. Enabling and disabling elements can be done via this modify element component by setting active to true or false. The elements are actually not removed from the system, but they are made very weak It's a so-called soft kill approach, and here this modification shall be applied to the element sets called diagonal A and B, and here I can now disable the elements. One sees that we have here now bending. In case that the rendering looks a little bit edgy, it's possible to increase the resolution a little bit here, not too much, and also the displacement, of course, increases dramatically. So with the diagonals, we have 1.6 centimeters, and without, about a tenfold displacement. However, sometimes it's useful to have this kind of V&A system, because without the diagonals, it's easier to realize openings, and diagonals are always something where one bangs the head on. So diagonals are very efficient from a structural point of view, but from an architectural point of view, not always desired, let's put it that way. Yeah, one can apply here also a second order theory calculation. Since the system's normal forces are not very large, one hardly sees a difference. Also, there's a small one. And a last thing, if you take a look at the buckling pattern of the system, one sees that if I add now the diagonals again, one sees now that the top girder starts to buckle, which is, in case of beams, called lateral torsional buckling. And this can be quite dangerous, because if the buckling length of these elements here is chosen in the wrong way, then the design procedures, according to Eurocode, underestimate the danger of buckling. So in Caramba, for example, and many other fine element programs, the standard buckling length of of an element is chosen to be the distance between the endpoints where more than one element and where more than two elements attach. So this would be hugely wrong in this case, because in this case the buckling length is actually from here to here, which is tenfold the distance between the posts. Okay, I hope today's session was interesting for you. And next time we will probably have someone to talk about Rhino and Rabbit, and maybe in 2 weeks we'll talk about stiffening systems. So have a nice time, and see you. Goodbye. There was a question. There's a question. Does Caramba take into account lateral torsional buckling also for simple beams? It does via the design procedures. If you do a cross-section optimization, or if you calculate the utilization of a beam according to Eurocode, then lateral torsional buckling is included. It is, however, not included in the calculation of the structural response of displacements and so on, because this would demand an additional degree of freedom. It's planned maybe in the future, but at the moment it's not in the calculation procedure. However, it is in the design procedure. So if you take a look, for example, at this modify element component, there's here the second order submenu, and here you can specify whether buckling shall be taken into account. You can set here the buckling length for buckling in Y and Z direction, and also for lateral torsional buckling. And if these lengths here, these three lengths parameters, are chosen correctly, then Natural torsional buckling should also be taken account of. And there is, okay, yeah. Okay, goodbye then. Oh, ist another question? No. Ich glaube, muss ich das drücken?
Ja. Ich habe das geändert. Ja.